Hey guys, it's Miss Woodruff again. I'm just here today to show you a more detailed, longer head-to-toe assessment. So this is a good video to watch if you're getting ready to, or if you have your graded assessment coming up. So this is that 50-point assessment. It has a little bit more details. It's a little bit more in-depth. So I'm gonna do my best to take you through kind of how I would do this assessment or how I do it. You do not have to do it just like me. And remember, it's not about perfect organization, but I'll show you kind of how it organized in my brain. It might help you if you're struggling with that organizational piece. So to get started in this assessment, of course, I'm going to need to gather equipment. I'm going to need a vital sign machine like I have here in order to take my patient's vital signs. I'm going to need a stethoscope. I have my phone, but you would need a pen light in order to do that. And that should be your main pieces of what you're going to need. I am going to go into the room, wash my hands, don some gloves, and I'm going to do that first thing. I know some people will do vital signs without donning gloves, but it's always good to get into the habit of putting those gloves on first thing when you go into the room, because you never know what you might come into contact with. I'm going to introduce myself. Hi, my name is Kat. I am from TCC, and I'm going to be performing a head-to-toe assessment. Do you have any questions? If they say no, then I'm going to make sure I provide for privacy. I'm going to close the curtain, close the door, and make sure that I am providing for privacy for us. Then I could attach my blood pressure cuff. I'm not going to go ahead and take their blood pressure and everything, but I could attach my blood pressure cuff and start with my vital signs. This gives me an opportunity to kind of see how the patient's doing and ask some questions. So while I would turn this on, take their temperature, put their oxygen probe on, check to see what, how they're doing. So I'm going to check their vital signs. And while they're doing that, I'm going to start asking some questions. Hi, can you tell me your name and date of birth? And I'm going to verify it. They can say it out loud and I can verify it with their ID bands. I'm also going to start asking them some orientation questions. So I'm going to ask them where they are, why they're there. I'm going to ask them the date and try to get a little more information about that. While I'm doing this and starting to talk to them, I'm already assessing for how well they can speak. And also, as I'm asking questions, I'm telling how well they can hear me, but I still can ask, do you have any problems with your speech? Do you have any problems hearing me when I'm talking? Anything like that, and kind of assess for that there. I'm also looking for their affect and their mood, their general posture. Do they look comfortable? Do they look like they're anxious? Do they look like they're calm? Do they look like they're having any problems? So I can start with that. I also want to ask really early on, are you having any pain, any problems? Right now? Do you have, like, you know, and I think that it helps in this assessment if you ask about pain and problems before every section, even though it's not required, it will really help you in the future if you kind of get into the habit, because someone may say, they're not in any pain, but then you get somewhere and they're like, oh, well, that hurts. So you always, it's better if you start early and ask about pain before doing other things. Sir, are you in any pain right now? And even if they say no, like I told you in other videos, I still ask on a scale of 0 to 10 what their pain is. If they are in pain, then I want to know more about it. Where is it? How long has it been there? What makes it better or worse? What does it feel like? How would they describe it? Just know for the purpose of this assessment, if there's anything a patient can't do because of their pain, you don't have to, like, let's say they just can't sit forward, you can't listen to the back of their lungs, that's okay. But if someone's in so much pain that you can't really do a full head-to-toe assessment, they're probably not the best patient to do. You won't get points off for anything that they can't do as long as you can verbalize it. At least that's how I grade. You might want to check with your instructor on that. So I'm all done taking their vital signs and starting with my basics. So I want to make sure to take this off. I do not want to leave this on for the duration of the assessment. And so now I'm going to move this out of the way. So far I have assessed my patient's hearing and verbal ability. I've also introduced myself, told them what the assessment is about. And by the way, I probably could also mention, hey, this assessment's going to take about 15, 20 minutes. That way they know how much time of theirs I'm going to take. And then I've checked my vital signs. I've checked their posture, their general affect, their mood, and kind of seen where they're at with that. So then I'm going to start. I always like to start at the top and work my way down. So I'm going to start with the patient's face. I've noted here that they're wearing glasses. So I like to start with the eyes. So I can ask them, okay, sir, do you wear those glasses all the time? Are they for reading or are they for seeing far away? How is that working? Can you see well with them? You know, so I might ask about that. And then I'm going to inspect their eyes. I'm going to look for their eyes. Is there any swelling, any abnormalities, any drainage, any difficulties with their eyes? Then I'm going to check for Perla. So what I'm going to do to check for Perla is I'm going to get my handy dandy flashlight and I'm going to go from the outside in and see if their pupils are reacting to light, which they should go from a bigger to a smaller size when they're reacting appropriately. So I'm looking for that appropriate reaction. And also I'll need to document later what size their pupil is at rest. And remember, it's preferred to do that with the lights down. So that's a good thing to start with. Turn the lights off, then you can turn them back on. That's something I didn't mention else in the beginning is always make sure you have good lighting. Maybe the patient has a headache or something. They can't handle the lights on. That's okay. But really in order to do a good inspection, I need to have the lights on. It doesn't have to be crazy bright, but I need some light. Anyway, so I've assessed their eyes. I've looked for any drainage, any problems. They have Perla. And to check for the accommodation, remember the accommodation is the thing where I go close and far away and see if their pupils change size as they are accommodating for the distance my finger makes. So I've checked their eyes. Now I'm going to check their ear. So I'm going to say, sir, can you turn your head this way? And I'm going to look in his ear, look, and obviously I wouldn't have to hold his chin like this. It's just because it's a mannequin. You know, I'm looking for any drainage, swelling, problems with his ear. And then normally I'll just go to the other side. But if depending on their size, if I can, because here I can't really see his ear, you'll want to go to the other side. I'm not going to show that, but you want to walk to the other side because otherwise it's kind of awkward, especially most people have a bigger body habitus. So, and then while I'm here in the ears, I also want to ask about any hearing devices. Do you wear hearing aids? Do you have any, we talked earlier, do you have any newer different problems with your hearing? Then I'm going to go to the nose. I'm going to ask for their nose. Like, do you have any seasonal allergies, problems with your nose, regular drainage? I'm going to look inside. I'm looking for a deviated septum. I'm looking for any drainage, any swelling, any problems, obstruction, anything like that. Then I'm going to look into the mouth. I'm going to say, open your mouth. I'm looking at the teeth and I'm noting, I might ask them, hey, are these your teeth? Are these dentures? Do you have a partial? I'm going to look to see if they have any decay caries. I'm looking for sores. I'm looking for skin breakdown in their mouth. I'm looking for how moist or dry that it is. I'm also going to look in their throat. This is a great time. This is when I best remember about the cough and the sputum. I know it's in respiratory, but for me, I always think the throat, sputum. So I usually ask now, like, hey, do you have a cough? Are you coughing anything up? What does it look like? It's also a good time for me to ask some GI questions. Hey, how's your appetite? Are you eating okay? Can you chew okay? And I also sometimes even like to ask, about if they're having any vomiting or any nauseousness, things like that. And if so, what that looks like. So then after I've looked and I've asked those questions, I'm gonna have them stick their tongue out and then they need to move it side to side like this. Side to side. So I'm gonna ask them to do that. And then I'm going to have them do some, I'll back up a second here. I'm also going to look for symmetry in their face. So now that I've done their mouth, that's the mouth. Before I move on to the neck and the shoulders, I'm going to look for symmetry in their face. So symmetry, I can look and just see, hey, everything's equal. But I might also say, give me a big smile and see if everything's equal, or tell them to raise their eyebrows because that can help to see if everything's equal. Next, I'm going to move on to the neck. Like I said, I like to go head to toe versus body system because it doesn't always work out that way. So I want the patient at, about 30 degrees, not too high, not too low. And I want to be looking at their neck for jugular venous distension or jugular vein distension, JVD. What I'm looking for, not touching, no palpation, just visualizing. And I can get my handy dandy flashlight out again. I'm looking on the neck and I'm looking for any distension in that vein, any like sort of congestion or buildup of fluid in the veins of their neck. I'm gonna look on both sides. I don't note any. Then I'm gonna have them do exercises with their shoulders. So I'm gonna tell them, can you lift your shoulders up? And then I'm gonna have them turn their head side to side and up and down. And that's checking for different cranial nerves. So I've done my head, I've done my neck, and I've done my shoulder muscles, checked for my JVD. Now I'm ready to go to my chest. So I always like to expose them just a little bit at a time. So I'm going to expose just here to the chest. And I am going to first start by inspecting. I'm going to look, and this is a good place. I mean, you should have already been doing it, but since you already looked very deep in the head, you should be looking around the neck and the chest, any skin issues. So I'm looking around. I'm seeing, is there any skin breakdown? Is there any rashes? Is there any lines or tubes? Like this patient has a central line right here. So I would want to note that if there's an IV or anything here, I want to assess it. Is there any problems, any redness? I would ask them, are you having any pain here? Any difficulty with that? Just kind of see what's there. If there's any skin breakdown, I would want to assess for it. I can feel a little bit about I could feel the temperature and then look at the color, if there's any abnormal color to their skin. But I'm effectively inspecting their chest. And I always like to start with respiratory. So while I'm inspecting their chest, there's a couple things that I can do while I'm talking to them without them knowing. I like to count their respiratory rate because that's one of my vital signs. Instead of just sitting there and staring at them being like, hold on a sec, I'm counting something. I like to do it when they're not thinking I'm doing it. So this is a great time as they're talking to start kind of counting and seeing how they're doing, as you're asking some questions. So I'm looking, I could count their respiratory rate. And just as a reminder, you can count. So you're going to count how many breaths they take. You can do 15 seconds and times that by four, or do 30 seconds and times it by two. Or if you want to be overzealous and do a full minute, which I don't recommend because that's a long time of staring at them, you can count for a minute. So I'm looking, and while I'm looking, I can also talk to them. Hey, do you have any history of lung problems or respiratory problems? And remember, those words don't mean a lot to people, so you want to be specific. Do you have any history of COPD, asthma, difficulty breathing? Ask about symptoms now. We already asked about the cough, but we could also ask about, like, hey, do you have any problems with activity? Like when you get up and walk or do activity, do you get short of breath? do you have any drainage, et cetera? So I'm always asking about those things. So then I would want to... ask about history of smoking. That's something that really directly affects most people with their respiratory system. So I always want to ask about that. Maybe if they're on any respiratory meds or anything like that as well. So ask a little about the history while I'm inspecting. And what am I inspecting for? I'm looking at respiratory muscles. Remember back to the respiratory focused assessment video that respiratory starts up at the nose. Is there any nasal flaring? Then I'm looking a lot here at the clavicles, at the shoulders, at the chest muscles, and even the abdomen. And I'm looking to see, are they... is there a lot of heaving? Is there a lot of work? Are the other muscles of their body having to work to help them to breathe? So I'm visualizing, is there any accessory muscle use? Is there any what we call retraction? That's when it sucks in on your tissue when you're working really hard. It's hard to describe it to you, but when you see it, you'll kind of see like the tissue gets sunken in as they're breathing because it's working so hard. So they can have retractions, accessory muscle use. That's what I'm looking for. I'm counting their respiratory rate and asking them about their history or any problems. Are you having any pain in your chest with your breathing would be another good question too. So now that I've asked some questions, I'm ready to listen. Now I like to listen and kind of do them back to back. So you can also ask about cardiac history here too. So I'm gonna listen to your heart and your lungs, but before I do you have any cardiac history or cardiovascular history? Do you have any chest pain that gets worse with activity or is at rest? Do you have, any history of a heart attack, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, any problem with your circulation, things like that? Those are the questions you might want to ask. After I get that history, then I'm ready to listen. So you can watch more in depth if you want to learn about exactly where we're listening. I'll do a quick review here. So I like to listen to lungs first. And, as an instructor, most instructors expect you to listen to heart and lungs separately. So you can't be like, hey, I'm listening to heart and lungs right here. I like to see them separate because there's two different, kind of approaches to them. So I'm going to show you first how to listen for lungs. So you put your stethoscope in, you get your diaphragm. You listen in the right upper region, and I'm listening, I'm actually going to go up a little bit higher. So I like it a little higher, kind of like right below the clavicle. So I'm going to listen, and I'm listening for air. I should hear air moving. Now, if they can get away without taking deep breaths, I'm going to have them do this without taking deep breaths. But if I need them to take a deep breath, I'll just ask, because it's always better for them not to get winded and out of breath doing this. So yes, if you notice, I'm going side to side and I'm listening in three places in the front. I'm going to listen one place on the side. So now I'm going kind of mid-axillary, kind of like here on the side. Listening for those are my lateral lung sounds. Listening side to side, listening for air. In the bottom lung sounds, you may have to have them take a deep breath because they're harder to hear. But effectively, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. So you can go left, right, it doesn't matter, as long as you're side to side, left, right, you know, as long as you're right. But I like to hear, because remember, there's three lobes in the lung. So you want to do upper, middle, and lower, and then the sides. For this patient, some people will have the patient sit up and listen to the back. You can do that. I, a lot of times, just listen to my back lung sounds when I check their skin on their back. It's completely up to you. So I'm going to wait till I assess my skin there. So I've listened to my lung sounds, and normally I would have just kept this, and now I'm going to listen to heart sounds. So I'm going to, again, start on the right side. So here's your sternum here. You want to go to the right sternal border. So I'm going to go to the right of my sternum. I'm going to listen on this right side, a little bit above the nipple. I'm listening for lub dub. I'm listening, and I'm going from here to over here, and then I'm going to make that C cup around the breast. And for this purpose of this assessment, when I get down to that apex, it's like if your clavicle's right here, you got to go a little bit left of the nipple. It's usually right there. And sometimes, again, you have to lift the breast. You can't listen on breast tissue for this. And you're going to listen for 60 seconds and you're going to count the pulse. So your instructor is going to expect you to give you a pulse at the end. So if you can't hear it, you need to move the stethoscope around until you can hear well enough. So even if it's like, hey, I can't hear anything there, maybe they have a lot of tissue. Go back up here. That's fine. Wherever you can hear and count for 60 seconds, so you can count that apical pulse. So we call it, or count the heart directly on the heart, count the pulse, because obviously up here is not the apex. Once you listen for 60 seconds, then you also, depending on your instructor's preference, you can either listen for murmurs. And so like for me with my stethoscope has a thing where I just have to push harder, and that's how I listen for murmurs. And so I could listen again in all the places and just push down harder and say I'm listening for murmurs. I don't have to listen for 60 seconds two times, just the one time. With most stethoscopes that students have here, this part twists and then it turns to turn on the bell, and you listen with the bell in five places to listen for murmurs. So now I've listened to lung sounds, I've listened to heart sounds, I've assessed the cardiovascular and the respiratory system. I want to cover the patient back up. And normally I would have them covered up their legs and stuff, but I figure I'll just leave them uncovered for this. So next I'm going to get into kind of a mix of musculoskeletal and peripheral neurovascular. So for this one, first I want to ask about pain. Hey, do you have any pain or problems in any of your joints, in your hands? You always want to ask that first, because a lot of patients will say they have no pain, but then you start moving their joints and they have a lot of pain in their joints. So I would ask about any pain or problems with the joints. Do you have any numbness or tingling in your hands or your feet? That's really good to know, because diabetics can sometimes have hyperesthesia, which is where they have like intense pain, like if a blanket on them feels like heavy fire. So you want to be very careful about that. So I'm going to start by looking, I'm inspecting, and I'm going down, I'm feeling on their skin, I'm looking for any abnormalities, if there's any IVs, I'm assessing for them, looking for any skin breakdown, I'm looking for any problems, I'm looking on both sides, if there's any device or anything, I'm taking them off, looking underneath them, I'm making sure to go all the way up on the shoulder here, and looking underneath everything, making sure to leave no skin unturned. So then I usually like to start by doing the cardiovascular because it's my favorite. So I'm going to feel on the radial pulse. And so I haven't brought this up in a lot of my other videos, but the radial, remember, is on by your thumb. So you should be able to feel it with your thumb. So I like to feel bilaterally so I can compare them. If you, patients can sometimes put their hands closer so you're not bending over so much. So I'm going to feel that. I don't have to feel for 60 seconds. I just need to feel for a couple seconds and get a feel for that pulse. Then I'm also going to check my capillary refill on both sides. And that's where I'm squeezing the finger. You can do the nail side or the finger side. And you're just squeezing and letting go and making sure the color returns. So I check that on both sides. Then I'm going to do muscle strength. So for muscle strength, I'm going to ask them to squeeze my hand as hard as they can and then push and pull against resistance with my hands. And it's hard to do that with the mannequin, so I apologize for that. But you can definitely look up videos, or your instructor should show you how to do that. So I'm going to pretty much, I have assessed my skin on my arms. I'm looking for edema. I'm looking for breakdown. I'm looking for color. I'm feeling for temperature. I'm checking pulses. I checked capillary refill. I checked muscle strength. I checked, against resistance, and also just hand muscle strength. So now I am ready to move on to my abdomen. So when I assess my abdomen, I always do like to cover up the patient and protect for their modesty. So I'm going to just expose the abdomen. And here I am, I'm going to start again with inspection. While I'm inspecting, hey, do you have any problems with your stomach? Have you ever had any reflux? Have you ever had any bowel disease, like irritable bowel, inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's, ulcerative colitis? Have you ever had any procedures to your abdomen? Have you ever had your gallbladder removed, maybe your appendix removed, et cetera? So I'm looking for anything that they might have. I'm looking for scars, and I'm looking for any tubes or devices. And with any tubes or devices, I always start at the patient and then work my way out. See if there's any problems here and make sure the device is functioning. See how much is coming out. What's coming out? What does it look like? So I'm also going to ask about any pain in their abdomen. Are you having any pain, any tenderness, difficulty? With your abdomen? I'm probably going to ask them when their last bowel movement was. I've already asked them about their appetite and their diet, but if I had it yet, I would ask them about their appetite and diet. Maybe what kind of diet have they been on? And so then I'm also looking at the same time while I'm talking to them, I'm looking at the contour. Is it rounded? Are they obese? Are they thin? Is there any abnormalities to their abdomen? After I'm done inspecting, then I'm going to auscultate. So I'm going to listen. I'm coming here, I'm starting in my right lower quadrant. Remember, I'm just listening long enough until I hear some gurgles, some tinkling or something else, you know, maybe 10, 15 seconds at most. If there's not a lot of sounds, I may have to listen longer. So I'm going to be listening in all four quadrants and listening, see if there's any sounds. After I'm done with that, then I'm going to let them know I'm about to palpate your abdomen. Let me know if you have any pain or tenderness with this. And I'm going to take one hand, just a light palpation, just a light push, push down in all four quadrants to see if they're having any pain or problems. Next, I'm going to move on. I like to get them covered so they can have their privacy. I'm going to move on to the urinary system. If they have a catheter, I'm going to start at the urethra and make sure that there's no discharge, no problems, that everything's intact, that it's attached appropriately to them. And I'm going to follow all the way to the bag and do a urinary assessment. If they don't have a catheter, then I'm going to ask them questions about their urination. So I want to ask them about, how is urination going? Are you having any pain, difficulty urinating, frequency of urination, any discharge, any issues? If it's a male patient, I might want to ask about flow issues. Do you have problems starting and stopping? Do you have problems when you are trying to empty and things like that as well? So I'm really trying to get to the bottom and find out about how well they're able to, evacuate their bladder and get their urine out. So after I've asked them those questions, I also want to think about how is their intake and output? So I may ask them about how well they're drinking. Are you taking in a good amount of fluid? Or if they have IV fluids hanging, I might look at that, look at their general hydration status, and check for that as well. We have in the past sometimes asked for skin turgor, skin turgor is where you can kind of pinch the skin a little bit and see how well they're hydrated. That's really a late sign of hydration, so it's not the best sign, but you can check that as well. And then I also want to consider if they're having, if they're, how often they're going. Are you using the restroom often? How are you getting up and moving around? It's a good kind of musculoskeletal question too. Are you able to get up out of bed? How are you using the restroom? Are they incontinent? Are they able to be continent? So just asking some questions about how they go, how often it goes, how it looks like. When you ask about the bowel movement and the urination, your patient may look at you kind of puzzled because they're like, why are you asking me that? I don't look at that stuff. But just tell them to do their best and, kind of maybe give them some examples. Like, don't just say, hey, is it normal? Because they don't really know what normal is. Hey, is it yellow? Is it clear? Things like that as well. For urine and for bowel movement, was it soft? Are you having any constipation, etc.? So I want to ask about the urinary system. And keep in mind for this assessment, you do not have to assess the genitals if there is no symptoms and if there is no device down there. But no, in real life, you always have to assess that area. It's not that it's just, hey, they don't have anything down there, so I'm good. It's really good as a nurse to get comfortable with going in different areas on the patient and be comfortable assessing them. You don't have to get awkward and uncomfortable and weird, but you should be able to look at your patient's genitals and say, okay, no signs of infection, everything looks good, because that's a part of your skin assessment. And to back up a little bit too, while you're here, you also need to check your skin folds. So if there's any sort of larger abdominal folds, you need to lift that up and look underneath and look for any skin issues or breakdown. So keep in mind the urinary area is an area of a lot of moisture, so there can be a lot of problems there. So always be looking for that. Then you're going to move to the legs. So when I'm looking at the legs, I'm first looking at integrity. You know, the patient has, a wound here. They have a wound on their toes. I'm noticing some breakdown and stuff like that. So I'm checking their skin. I'm going to check for edema. So I'm going to feel down their legs, see if there's any swelling here. I can do the pitting test, push down and see if my fingerprint stays there. So I'm checking for the pitting. I'm also checking for color and temperature as well as I'm doing that. Then I'm going to come here to the end. I'm going to feel my dorsalis pedis pulses. Remember, that's the one that's on the top of the foot. Then I'm also feeling behind in the inside of the ankle. I'm feeling for the posterior tibial pulse. And then checking my capillary refill on these toes. And then I'm also having the patient push down on my hands like they're pushing on a gas pedal to check for musculoskeletal. And then I'd also tell them to push their feet up against my hands to check for that muscle strength. One thing I think I forgot on the uppers too is after I have them do muscle strength, I also have them do range of motion. I have them kind of move their wrists, move their shoulders, move their arms, kind of show me that they have good range of motion. We want to do the same with the legs, wiggle their toes, move their ankle, you know, bend their knee up and around, things like that as well. So I usually find it helpful after I do strength to think range of motion right after. After that, I just want to check other places for skin. I want to look at the heels and look for any issue in the heels. You always need to take the patient's socks off. I know it's hard sometimes if you have a patient who's dressed, but do your best. You want to look underneath everything and inspect to the best of your abilities. Then either your instructor or if the patient's able to turn themselves, then you're going to have them turn on their side. So that you can look at their back. So you want to look at their back. You want to look for any breakdown, especially in the back, in the coccygeal area, in the top of the buttocks, or if there's any pressure points around here, you want to look down the back, see if there's any problems. And then this is a good time to listen to lung sounds. So if someone else is holding, you listen starting at the top, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And so you're going that zigzag pattern again. So once again, you're looking down the back, you're checking every area for any device and see there's all these devices underneath them. So I would try to move all these tubes out of the way so that they do not have any pressure injuries. So as I'm doing that, I want to always make sure that I am protecting for as much modesty as I can, that I'm checking for pain throughout, if they're having any problems, that I am assessing for those. If they are able to, I want to see that, like, you know, if I haven't already seen them get up and walk around, I usually want to ask, like, hey, how are you walking? Do you, are you steady? Do you need to use any devices? I may also ask about, I may also ask about, how much assistance that they need, if they need an extra person or something like that as they're walking. The only thing I think I forgot, which is pretty good for the fact that there's 44 things that I had to get through, is that, because I think I said it, but I'm not sure, but make sure when you're doing the throat, when you talk about chewing and appetite, you're also asking about swallow. Some instructors may want you to actually have the patient swallow something. Me personally, as an instructor, I just like you to ask and then, show me how you would. I mean, if the patient, I don't want to force someone to drink something if they don't want to, but if you have some water there and you can have them just look at that and take a drink of that water, you can do that as well. Whenever you're done with your assessment, you want to make sure your patient is fully clothed, button up all their buttons, and then you want to put their bed back down to a safe low position as you left them. Make sure that their call light is by them, that you cover them up, and that you leave them as they once were. So if you took their socks off, put their socks back on, ask them if they have any questions. And I think it's always good as a student to ask for feedback. Do they have any feedback? Is there anything that you could do better or different? Most people will probably say this is the most thorough assessment they've ever had in their life. So they probably enjoyed it, but don't be afraid to ask for feedback. It definitely helps. If you have any questions or comments, let me know. See you later.